Hello, Internet! Welcome to the premiere of Season 2 of That Random Podcast Show! Yes, we're back in 2017, and I don't think we're going to be lasting for very long here, ladies, gentlemen, and others, because a great, horrific event has occurred in this great country, the United States, which we are recording from. It's something that has to be addressed, and it's something that must be brought to the attention of the world as a whole. It's a great event that may, in fact, herald the beginning of the end of everything. I am, of course, speaking about M. Night Shyamalan making a good movie for the first time in almost a decade.
I don't believe this. What is this nonsense? I don't believe anything that you're saying right now. I'm feeling kind of split about this whole thing.
No! Yes, it is true. It is is officially part of the end times, right up there with a live-action Garfield movie getting made, M. Night Shyamalan making a good movie after Unbreakable.
Don't forget, Garfield had a sequel, all right? And so did Scooby-Doo, so you watch your mouth.
All signs of the apocalypse. It's all there in the Book of Revelations. Read the Bible. You know, it's all scientific. But... All right. We've had our fun here, but yes, welcome to That Random Podcast Show, ladies and gentlemen. We're back. I'm Tyler. My co-host is Michael, and we're here to talk about nerd stuff and occasionally movies, such as, yes, the very fact that M. Night Shyamalan's Split has actually came around to actually be considered a good movie. Like, it's good, legitimately good, with James McAvoy giving a good performance, and there's actually a legitimately holy crud twist that makes the movie work, in addition to the movie working on its own merits. I'm like...
Yeah, well, I mean, it did spend the last 2 weeks before its recording at the number one spot, which, granted, it didn't have much competition. Well, except for Resident Evil. Resident Evil is a pretty big competitor. But yeah, it's been some... hey, man, people love Resident Evil movies, all right? I don't know why, but they like Wes Anderson's movie. But, you know, it spent 2 weeks up there, which I'm sure even M. Night Shyamalan was surprised about, so... Hey, it must be good.
Oh my gosh, I actually listen to people. dear.
So my question is, have you seen Split yet? Because I haven't seen it. I had no.
I have not, only because I've heard it's good, but it seems like the kind of movie that I would probably watch if it came to Netflix or like a rental. Like, I wouldn't go out to movie theater to see it, because it's kind of a horror-themed movie that has a kind of retrograde approach to dissociative identity disorder or split personalities, and I find this to be kind of exploitative, but if that's your thing.
Yeah, I mean, I had some interest in it even before I found out it was M. Night Shyamalan. Even after I found out, I didn't really, you know, I'm not really the people who's like, oh, it's an M. Night movie, it's time to avoid. I'm like, well, you know, people make crud, you know, sometimes they come back and they make good stuff. Is M. Night Shyamalan's movie really that bad? No, I think it's just that a lot of people really like his first, like, what, 2-3 movies?
Yeah, and The Sixth Sense, Unbreakable. Signs is kind of contentious, but
people,
fans.
Yeah, people did like Signs, and it did well. It's just, I think people hyped him up so much in their own way that all his other movies were like, yeah, it's M. Night, but it's not really something that I care about.
Having said that, though, I will admit Shyamalan kind of did that to himself when it came to him kind of attacking his own critics. Like, I remember he fed a film critic to a monster and Lady in the Water, and I'm like, oh my gosh, man. Yo, have some dignity.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah. Even Quentin Tarantino had fun with his own characters and blew himself up in Django Unchained. Like, you got to have some kind of fun with yourself.
Yes, absolutely. But... Moving away from Split, since we really can't comment about it, and we're a professional podcast show, there. Shut up! We are.
Darn it! That'll never happen.
Darn you! But yes, quite a bit has happened since we last recorded and sent 2016 off with a salute and a flipping of the bird and a burning of the corpse. But
and that corpse that we burned was the bird.
So sad, bird. Sad bird.
Pretty sure that bird didn't want to go into 2017 anyway. It had enough of 2016.
Wow, that got dark really quickly. But yes, quite a bit.
We just talked about an M. Night Shyamalan movie. Like, I don't think it can get any darker than that. Although I did see a movie called Cage recently. Have you heard that movie before? Have you seen that one?
I have not. Please inform me.
Ooh, yeah, that'll have to be something that we watch and talk about at a later date. But it's about this guy who works in an animal shelter. And one day he runs into this woman on the bus that he knew in high school, I believe. And he becomes obsessed with her and starts stalking her and like recording things that she likes and dislikes. And then one day just downright kidnaps her.
And what the hell?
Oh,
man?
Oh yeah. He sets up this cage for her inside this abandoned part of the animal shelter. And it's so deep within the shelter that nobody can hear her scream. And nobody knows that she's there. So he kidnaps her, put her in this cage, and just, it's crazy. I can't talk about it too much because like it has a couple of twists in there. And if I give away too much of the synopsis, it kind of ruins it. Because once you start looking at it, you can tell some things that go like something like there's a certain part that's like, oh, this is going to happen. And it happens. I'm like, well, I saw that coming, but it's still fun. It's a good movie. It's interesting. And also finally saw Swiss Army Man.
Oh, my gosh. Swiss Army Man. The sort of survival comedy movie about Daniel Radcliffe playing a surprisingly helpful corpse.
Yeah, it was pretty surreal and not as great as I was hoping it was going to be. But at the same time, I was just interested.
It was a great showcase of Radcliffe's range. I mean, I noticed people really praised how Radcliffe was able to act in it. So
yeah, it was interesting to see these two people interact throughout the movie, and it had some pretty fun twist in it. But all in all, it kind of ends the way you think it would, with a surreal indie film feel to it. But yeah, if you haven't seen Cage, look it up. No, I'm sorry, not Cage. Pet. It's called Pet.
Ew.
Yeah,
that's even more messed up.
Yeah, yeah, it's called Pet. You can find it in Redbox. I'm sure you can. And also, Swiss Army Man was okay. It wasn't bad. It wasn't that great, but it's watchable. So there's that. Look at that. We got through like 3-4, probably even 6 months of movies right there.
Yeah, we do seem to linger a bit much on, but a few things also happen in the world of video games. You know, those blinky, loud things that we dedicate a lot of our time and energy to.
Like Pong.
Well, yes, I do remember that good old Pong back in the good old days. Oh, boy, don't I tell you what. Oh, harumph.
I say, good man, back in my day, we used to play a good round of Tetris.
You don't play a good round of Tetris with somebody else. You solitarily play Tetris. Unless you got the competitive mode going on.
Oh, yeah. That competitive arcade, side by side. You're not really going against each other, but you are. Because the game's like, hey, both of you playing the same game. See who get the high score. And everybody's like trying to beat each other. See who can get to a further level and who can see how fast you can get your pieces down. It's fun, people.
I believe that, but quite a few reviews I've actually sent through and have been certain games I've been seeing and being adequately hyped for as they're slowly unraveling and showing themselves. Like, believe it or not, a small surprise I actually did review recently was actually Double Dragon 4, which I'm glad existed. You know, celebrating 30 years of Billy and Jimmy fighting, you know, bad guys and, you know, doing the whole 80s action movie thing of saving the world and saving the girl and getting into fist fights with burly men with knives and pipes.
And women. Don't forget, they also fought women.
Oh, yeah, they're equal opportunity ass kickers. Good stuff. Personally, I still think some of the original Double Dragons were a bit better with how they handled their pacing, which is really weird to say to an old arcade game. But Double Dragon 4 is a lot of fun, especially if you still have like enough controllers for couch co-op. I actually forgot how much fun it was to actually just play those, you know, with a buddy and just like team up and just beat down an Abobo together, or those weird like masked guys look like they've watched The Road Warrior too much, or those really annoying guys that throw the bolas. But that's me going on a tangent. There was also another game that I actually got introduced to. That I'm very much aware has a very devout fan base and it's been around, it's been making games in this series for like 16, 15 years, if I recall.
Sonic the Hedgehog.
I said 16 or 15 years, man. Not crashing and burning after 20 years and living off nostalgia alone like some disgusting vampire.
Mario?
You just heard a facepalm, ladies and gentlemen. This man just made me facepalm on a live recording. This is the beginning of our glorious season, gentlemen, ladies, others.
It's how we do things here. but please do go on.
I'm actually talking about the Tales JRPG series. Tales of Blank is how they got their name. Tales of Symphonia. Tales of the Abyss. Tales of Celia.
Silly person, I'm pretty sure you mean Chronicle XZ Philadelphia Metroid.
No, believe it or not, I actually like this naming convention compared to other JRPGs I've tried playing. There's an actual demo for a JRPG I played on my 3DS that's an original IP that was titled, and I'm quoting here, 7th Dragon V3 Code VFD.
Oh, come on! I was just making fun of a title, and you mean to tell me that's it? That's a title? That's even worse than what I came up with.
Yes, that's an actual title of an actual JRPG that Sega released, which is really strange because when I played the demo, it's actually really good. It's just that name is so terrible, but moving on.
I mean, even Xenoblade held back with this last game.
Xenogears, Xenosaga, Xenoblade Chronicles, you know, it's easy to slot into that. What happens if there's a sequel to whatever the heck I just said before, 7th Dragon Code 3 VFD Dragon whatever? How do you do that? But that's a tangent.
Yeah, ask Square Enix with their Kingdom Hearts games.
There's a reason why I haven't been able to get into the Kingdom Hearts series because of all the ridiculous chronology and spinoffs and insanity. I'm like, forget this. Just no. I'm just going to wait until there's a coherent compilation on PS4, and then I'm going to look up a walkthrough and then just destroy my brain trying to get through all of it.
Good for you, because Square Enix just released yet another compilation of Kingdom Hearts games.
I am aware they're releasing 1.5 and 2.5 HD for the PS4, I think either near the end of this month or March. But I'm also aware of the 2.8 HD thing, which, gosh darn it, no. How did we get on this topic again? Sorry, back to...
Bad Japanese games names.
It's ha-ha-ha-ha-ha. I am terrible. But... Yes, the Tales franchise I'm okay with, because that's actually a very solid naming convention. As I mentioned before, Tales of Symphonia, Tales of Xelia, Tales of Vesperia, Tales of etc. Self-contained adventures of interesting characters and interesting storytelling. This is what I've been hearing by reputation. Because usually whenever I think of JRPGs, they usually have a very simple structure to them, much like how people what most people think of when it comes to Western RPGs. They have their cliques, they have their tendencies. But people have mentioned to me that the Tales JRPGs do actually go a very long way with mixing up things, with not going through Chosen One versus Ancient Evil stuff. Like, they mix things up. And my first unfortunate introduction to the series was a review copy of Tales of Zestiria a long time ago. And it's considered the black sheep of the family, and I could see why, because everything I mentioned before about how people kept saying it's not a generic JRPG of generic proportions with good storytelling. This was a horribly generic, milquetoast, bland adventure with some of the worst exposition and environmental storytelling I've seen in my life, with some pretty bad cutscene structure, and it bored me to tears within like an hour, and that was impressive.
And you like those slow burn kind of story things, which RPGs are known for. Like,
Eastern and Western, no matter where it's from.
All RPGs are like that, so I can see why some people don't like RPGs because of that, but...
No. You're talking to somebody that I love RPGs. I love those slow boils. I love those intrigue moments. This Zestiria was just... Oh my gosh!
Right, that's what I'm saying. Like, you actually enjoy those kind of things, so the point that it bored you within an hour says a lot.
Yeah. Like, seriously, imagine if somebody told you, hey, watch this, it's totally not like an action movie. And then you watch it, and in the first 5 minutes, there's an insane car chase, and there's gunfire, but it's all shot horribly, and you can see the wires and the stunt work, and the acting is something from the Sci-Fi Channel. You'd walk up to this friend and slap him in the face, wouldn't you?
Well, no, I'd walk out and burn the house that they were in, so that way I would never be subjected to any of their ideas ever again.
Yeah, I got a very bad first impression in a similar fashion. Not to that extreme extent with Tales of Zestiria, but it stopped me for a while. But then I started seeing the previews for Tales of Berseria, which is their latest installment. And I'm not going to lie, it actually kept my interest until I heard it was supposed to be a direct... It was supposed to be a prequel to the events of Tales of Zestiria. Now, yeah, this is all my baggage I have with this, but I got some good news. I played it, and suddenly I was like 25 hours into it, and I couldn't stop. Like, the time just flew by as I was playing it the sections I could find, in the time I could find. And I started liking it. And, well... The review just sort of flew on my fingers, and I always enjoy playing games that do that. Like, I don't like reviewing crap, because that's hard. Sometimes it can be therapeutic, but for a while I've been reviewing stuff that's mediocre. It's okay. It has some problems, but has some good parts, and it's very difficult to sometimes articulate. Like Steep, or Double Dragon 4. Berseria was a breath of fresh air of something I needed. It was something I needed at the time. So, you know, enough being around the bush. Berseria is a very narrative-focused JRPG. You're basically playing, effectively, a villainous type character, a sort of demon that's trying to assassinate the head of a theocratic order. You're a demon trying to kill the Pope, basically.
That is a weird way of putting it. You're trying to kill the Pope. Wait, whoa, people like the Pope, so yeah, you're a demon, all right.
And the strangest thing imaginable is that, for the record, the game is not some giant condemnation of religion. Let me make that perfectly clear for any Satanist or atheist jagoffs that are going to be, you know, praising this thing based off of my very general assumption. The entire narrative is actually focusing around the conflict between reason and desire, because it's basically the fascist logic Pope, for lack of a better term. I think I coined that in the review. He has an order that revolves around pragmatism and personal sacrifice for the greater good, which leads to, you know, the sacrificing of human rights, the sacrificing of, you know, quality of life, sacrificing of personal freedoms for protection, and blah blah blah. It gets a demon outbreak, and the protagonist has a very personal and seething rage against this leader, mostly due to, you know, something that usually kind of happens with certain tragic anti-heroes, you know, like family member murder and leaving them for dead after cutting their arm off. So it's really strange. It's a demon versus a holy man story, and you want to root for the demon to kick the holy man's ass.
That still sounds awful.
It's strange.
Yeah, it still sounds awful. Are you playing the bad guy? Like, are you trying to destroy the world? Like, dismantle the establishment?
It's really strange. Like, it's always like the character has a very one-note desire to basically kill this character. I am not doing it enough justice with his presentation with how I'm explaining it, but. As I said, it's still a traditional JRPG where you're still collecting party members and, you know, level grinding and going, and it's very linear narrative focus, so there's cutscenes and, you know, delivery. But I love it because it doesn't take control from the player. It's good cutscene discipline. Like, you really want to see an example of how not to do cutscenes? Go to Resident Evil 5. You want to see how to not do cutscenes?
Or any Square Enix game ever made?
I would say PlayStation 2 era Square Enix, though those rely way too much on spectacle. So the earlier stuff was experimental, and you know, I'm more forgiving of that. But yeah, I'm talking about instances where, you know, where the characters actually act and maintain things, and if a character's speaking to them, it's either because they can't do something or whatever. It's well done. Like, this is something that always bothers me whenever people kind of guffaw cutscenes in their games, because there's been a sort of stigma against cutscenes in video game narrative, especially in more recent years. People want to keep things interactive. They want to keep things in-engine. Like, they don't want to keep, you know, taking the player out of it. They want to maintain their immersion. And that I understand.
Right, just like Ubisoft doesn't want to do cutscenes in their games anymore.
They're... yeah. they want to try to enhance that immersion by not leaving the control, by not taking control away from the player if they can help it. So when cutscenes happen, they're like, "Oh, ooh, why are you doing this? I don't like this at all." The trick, though, is doing it in a way that makes sense, so that you don't feel as if control is being wrestled from you, and your player avatar or the player you're controlling comes off as a completely incompetent doofus. Like I mentioned before, Resident Evil 5, you're trying to kill Wesker. You're trying to stop him from destroying the world. And yet there are multiple cutscenes where he gets in front of the heroes, brags and guffaws about how evil of a mustache-twirling baddie he is, holds up the virus he says he's going to destroy the world with. There's nothing between him and the heroes. And then he runs away, and they're like, "Darn it, we let him get away." And that happens multiple times.
Because there's no boulder to punch.
And it is crazy. Like, let me see if I can actually start from the beginning to kind of retcon a terrible first impression. Like, as the Tales series, first of all, the Berseria does have a good unique selling point. The main hero, the main character you play as, is actually the series' very first female character. Her name is Velvet Crow.
Wait, I'm sorry. Say that name again.
Yes. That's the name.
That sounds like a horrible, horrible name, but I will let it go because I'm sure she's part of some legacy or some legendary family.
Actually, no. That's what's kind of strange. The name is kind of on the nose, but she's part of a somewhat broken family where her mother and father died, and she's taking care of her younger brother with the help of her brother-in-law.
All right, well, so far she sounds not as interesting as I'd hope. But please, continue to tell me about Miss Crow.
Hey, watch it. Certain studios have more on-the-nose names than that. Although, this isn't kind of the running that I'm thinking about. But yeah, the prologue is kind of your standard tutorial sort of thing. It's like, you're taking care of your brother. Here's the combat tutorial. Here's how you can fight boars to get food. You go shopping. This is a little village. It's also quaint, whatever. And of course, in my head, I'm hearing a countdown till, plot happens. And of course, plot happens. With a demon attack that happens, where people are turned into horrible monsters by some event called the Scarlet Knight. And, as you can imagine, the village doesn't last. And apparently
Scarlet Knight should have been the name of the main heroine. That would have been cooler.
I think your idea of cool and my idea of cool are two different things, but this is something I do have to say, though. She tries looking for a brother-in-law who turns out is part of an ancient order of exorcists that are capable of dealing with these demons because other physical means can't take them down. She finds him just in time to see him conduct a blood ritual, a horrible ritual to sacrifice her younger brother and initiate a ritual in order to gain some extra power in order to fight back the demons. Of course, she doesn't see that. She just sees, my little brother just got murdered by my brother-in-law, you're a horrible person, I'm going to go kill you. And he proceeds to cut her arm off and kick her into the pit with her brother.
So, it's Fullmetal Alchemist mixed with 300. I like this so far.
It actually feels closer to Old Boy because...
Whoa. Now, hold on. No, hear me. That's a lot of hype right there.
No, it feels closer to Old Boy since you kind of say Fullmetal Alchemist meets Old Boy because when she gets kicked into the pit, her soul kind of falls into the underworld, but due to her rage at what the hell her brother just did, she comes back as a demon entity with a demon arm. So if you see the previews, why she has this giant, like, red energy arm, whatever, that's the reason for it. And she starts attacking. And apparently, she can feed off of demon blood to gain power, so that's the rationale for the RPG element sort of stuff. And he manages to knock Velvet out because he can't seem to figure out how to put her down permanently because unusual entity, and locks her away into prison on a remote island for 3 years. From there, you escape, and from there you escape, gain allies from other horrible criminals and outlaws that have been locked up in the prison, make it to the mainland, and then you find out then 3 years he has basically instigated this very authoritarian order based off of, we must rationally oversee you in order to rationally, through reason and strength, just fight back this horrible demon outbreak. And she's going to kill him because, yeah, congratulations, you issued an order by murdering a child.
Sacrifices must be made, man.
And that's his rationale. Her rationale is, doesn't matter, it's still wrong. Here we go, we have conflict.
Like I said, it's
an anti-hero narrative. It's not necessarily villainous. But villainous tendencies do happen.
What gets me with RPGs is the gameplay. Is it at least engaging? Is it entertaining? The story sounds interesting, but...
Have you played any of the prior Tales games?
No, actually, I've always skipped out on them. And after Final Fantasy 15, RPGs are kind of a stickler for me for some reason.
I gotcha.
Like after Mass Effect, like, oh wow, this is way more engaging than a lot of RPGs I've played recently. So like,
I actually enjoy the Mass Effect trilogy thoroughly, and I am hopeful Andromeda is okay. But I understand the point. Like, it sounds like you want something more action oriented that isn't just stuck to
not even action oriented. Just like, I want something that's a little more engaging than go through sub menus, press button, hope that the random number generator is on your side.
Actually, that's not the case. Like, the Tales franchise is actually built off of this sort of system they have called the linear movement combat system. That's what they've called it for a long time. And it's basically closer to a brawler, actually. You learn some new commands, some new comps, new attacks, and you map them to your face button. So you can, fight, with whatever. And certain attacks have certain values or whatever else. And the appeal comes from actually chaining these attacks together into combos and juggles, which you can do against certain enemies. You can stun lock them if you use a certain attack type right or whatever. So there's some menu management when it comes to managing your attacks. Over, but once the battles begin, it feels closer to like an action brawler, almost like Devil May Cry. There is some stamina management where you have to back off or use certain items or builds in order to give yourself more stuff. But then they add in other elements where you can basically overclock your combo and go into crazy, multiple hit stuff, and as the combo rises, your attack damage rises. So it's very skill-oriented, but also involves planning. And it gets very chaotic because the other members of your party are also fighting with you in real time against these enemies. So while you're doing crazy juggles with Velvet's demon arm and slicing up, you have maybe a mage that's throwing magic, you have one of your support guys, somewhere else beating the crud out of a werewolf with his bare hands, stuff like that.
That does sound plenty interesting.
It's very chaotic, but I will admit it's good. I will admit that once you learn enough about it, it's good, and I do mean that in a good way.
Right. So, like, is it easy to learn, hard to master, kind of thing?
I picked it up pretty quickly, but that's more or less due to my experience with more brawler focused gameplay. But there is a good learning curve, and it keeps you engaged. Like, it's really odd. Like, I really can't really describe it any other way. Like, it feels closer to a brawler. There is a level of mastery to it, but there's also some hard numbers to the RPG formula, like item mastery, equipping armor, different types of armor and weapons. There's actually a cooking mechanic where you actually have to cook food that can give you buffs and the like. So there is some RPG crunch there. But as long as you maintain a certain level of management to that, though, the fights are basically indistinguishable from an arcade beat 'em up, and it's exactly as engaging as it sounds. But personally, from somebody who barely played the Tales games, Berseria was actually an okay introduction to the franchise. Like, the opening was pretty bad. The tutorial stuck to menus, blocks of text that just explain stuff, and I don't like that. It's very antiquated. We should have done away with it a long time ago. But eventually they actually introduce elements where you actually have to, like, basically demonstrate what's been taught after they bring in new elements. And as intrusive as that is, I prefer to have that rather than saying, oh, by the way, you can do this and then never mention it again. It's much more savvy tutorialization than some RPGs do. Like, seriously, the minute I'm playing a game and their idea of a tutorial is to flash up, like, 6 or 7 panels of blocks of text telling you how to move, punch, block, eat food, switch party members, and just have
punch, block is all in your mind.
Yeah, paragraphs about paragraphs of text and saying, okay, you clearly understood all of this. No need to internalize this at all. You're off to the races. The minute they do that, I'm like, nope, you failed. This is a major AAA game for $60. We've come a lot farther than this. You do not get to call that a tutorial, but
So the Tales of, what was it called? Tales of Berseria.
Berseria.
So, all right, there's that, and you've actually been playing another RPG that you've told me that you were addicted to. And apparently you and everybody else on my Twitter timeline. Tell me a little bit about this Heroes game of yours.
Fire Emblem Heroes.
That's not a sound anybody should ever make. So
Shut up, it's my life. I do what I want.
That's not like more like a crying / I don't know what's going on in my life kind of thing. But yeah, go ahead. Fire Emblem Heroes. Apparently just the big new thing for Nintendo.
I do what I want, Michael. But yes. Of course, the other major thing that did come out from Nintendo is another installment in their crack at the mobile gaming market with Fire Emblem Heroes, which is a free-to-play version of the grid-based, turn-based tactics game that was popularized by Intelligent Systems and, of course, is part of the Fire Emblem series. And it's kind of an odd duckling, if you ask me, because Fire Emblem has had multiple installments in Japan. They are very well known for their great, well-polished tactical gameplay. But they never really caught on in the West. Like, there was its single premiere on the NES, didn't really take off. There were some very limited runs of the series on the GameCube and the Wii, didn't really take off. And it wasn't until Fire Emblem Awakening on the 3DS came out that it finally caught its audience and started, you know, gaining traction over here. So there's, like, multiple games, and the two most recent ones are the ones that people seem to really enjoy here in the United States and elsewhere. And Fire Emblem Heroes is effectively a free-to-play game that is built on the conceit of inter-game crossover. Yeah, they're doing this whole thing. The entire structure
just
of...
Just like with Hyrule Warriors.
Hyrule Warriors.
They're doing whole generations of Fire Emblem in one game.
Basically, yes. There's this entire plot line about two warring kingdoms, one that can apparently open portals to other worlds and pull resources from there, and one other clan that can close them. It's obviously very silly high fantasy nonsense, but one clan goes evil, starts pulling in evil characters or good characters from the other games, and, you know, puts them under contract to follow their orders. So now the good people have to, get the help of basically the player to bring in other characters. And so that facilitates the turn-based combat, and it's also part of its free-to-play model because you earn orbs in the game as you complete battles and go through these story chapters, which you spend on basically an RNG system where you randomly get heroes of different weapon types and tactical types in the various games, and you get them in this party, which you can then level grind, train, and then take them into battles. You can even fight other players through a PvP mode. And, as I said, it's really strange because the minute I recognize characters from, like, Awakening, from Fire Emblem Awakening or the more recent Fire Emblem Fates, you know, I see characters like, you know, Tsubaki or Lanku or Korin, and I'm like, hey, that's cool, and then I get a character from Fire Emblem Shadows of Something, only released in Japan, whatever, I'm like, who the heck is this person? I don't know this person at all. And it feels a bit dissonant. Having said that, though, I really love what Intelligent Systems did with Fire Emblem Heroes. I've been very vocal when it comes to the free-to-play elements of free-to-play markets. Usually when it comes to the free-to-play stuff coming into AAA games, but that's a topic for another time. The free-to-play elements in Heroes, I am very much content with, because there's a lot of management and a lot of stuff that helps mitigate it. Like, there's a stamina system, so you can only do so much at a time, which I know people aren't really against. But there's just enough content and enough levels there that you there's plenty for you to get through, but there's also these other items you can get, like a stamina potion that refills your bar. And I've got so many of them, I could effectively play nonstop for a whole day and not pay a single cent and just keep finding more stuff to play. And the RNG is actually pretty decent. Like, they have different tiers of warrior, like different versions of the same character, if you will, bronze, silver, and gold tier, respectively, all of which can be leveled up, all of which have their own skill trees, all of which have their own special skills you can utilize. You can have your own team loadouts for these different matches. Like, it's the exact kind of dense, strategic, you know, deliciously, you know, complex gameplay that I've come to love about the Fire Emblem games, but with just enough simplicity for mobile that it isn't overwhelming. Like, the grid for the combat is much smaller, and the sorties are usually four units versus four other units, as opposed to these, you know, massive battlefields that come up normally. And it does enough. It's bite-sized, it keeps you thinking, and for people who I know that have probably have found a way to play the other versions of the Fire Emblem games somehow, or maybe found, like, fan translations or whatever, they probably really get a kick out of some of these characters like, working with or working around each other. But for me, I'm enjoying it, but I'm at the same time, I'm also enjoying the fact that, you know, there are these characters I don't recognize. And something tells me that's going to become less of a case when the remake of Fire Emblem Gaiden comes out later, which is now being retitled Fire Emblem Shadows Over Valentia, which I'm fine with. I'm really glad that this series is getting some love, because I know a lot of people who keep thinking Nintendo is only known for several franchises and don't do a whole lot otherwise. And then Intelligent Systems comes in with this very well put together turn-based strategy game, and people are like shutting up now.
So it's a good way for them to introduce new characters. Well, characters that aren't new, but new to certain regions. And just like Nintendo did with the last Super Smash Brothers, when they introduced Sheik, and right before their game came out, was it Sheik?
No, it was
that? Oh man, it was a Fire Emblem character.
Not Corrin.
No, I forgot his name.
Lucina.
Was it?
Lucina. Yeah, Lucina was basically a key character of Fire Emblem Awakening, and that came out roughly around the same time before Smash 4 came out, so it was kind of a way of marketing it.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, just like when that character came out, you know, it's a great way to introduce new characters. Now, since it's free-to-play, we all know what that means. Microtransactions. Yep. You and I have both voiced our dismay for such a thing. No matter what, whether it's a $60 game or $40 to $60 game like Overwatch or free to play like Pokemon Go, microtransaction can always find a way to ruin a good game. But you mentioned that it's actually not that invasive.
It's not that intrusive. As I said, they have multiple different challenge tiers for all the different levels. And for every time you beat the level one time, the first time, you get an orb. So basically. It's effectively skill-based in terms of trying to mitigate your costs in some areas. Like, every single chapter of the game, which has, like, six or seven levels, has a hard mode and a lunatic mode version of that exact same level. So, if you train up your guys enough, you can basically earn more orbs by fighting. There's also some very generous login bonuses for coming back to the game multiple times. There's even a sort of PvP competitive focus, where if you win X amount of games in a row, you get other items as well, which can also help mitigate the stamina system and help boost your units. There is a training tower, where you can basically fight random sorties against other enemies of fixed levels, so you can basically power level up some of your other units and try to figure out new combos and synergies with, you know, certain mages or archers or beast riders. So there's a lot for you to work with what you already have, and as long as you keep powering through and learn and getting more, you can get plenty of orbs for plenty of stuff. And they have it be that whenever you try to roll a new character, you basically get five orbs that come up of different colors, which represent a certain enemy, a certain character type, a certain weapon type, a certain tactical type, so to speak. And once you pick one, you know, you spend your orbs, the die roll happens, and then whatever you get what you get. But if you go to the other four orbs otherwise, it actually lowers the cost of the orbs you spent, and it increases the RNG odds of getting a better character. So it actually encourages getting these orbs in mass, either through large amounts of play or by paying, and actually rewards awards you for doing this. And I found it to be a much more interesting system than just having an otherwise insane RNG and just trying to get you to, you know, pull the slot machine again. It's another form of strategic thinking, which is once again a testament to Fire Emblem. I also looked over the orb payments, and some of it is a bit much. Like, I noticed, like, for 3 orbs it costs about $2, and for that exact, so it's either $2 or I basically win 3 story mode matches. A bit much with that, but I get the feeling that that's going to change as things go long term. But the early game is really good with how it handles it. And I've gotten really lucky and actually gotten some silver tier heroes, and that's keeping my attention.
Okay. So is the random loot as bad as Overwatch?
As I said before, though, this is something I do have some. I know some fans will have some problem with. Originally, the original Fire Emblem games, you have your units, but you also have to manage their gear and their items they have. You know, this character's a lanceman. You have to have a bronze lance, iron lance, or steel lance. The better the lance, the better the damage. You know, usual RPG stuff. In this game, however, the RNG is focusing entirely just on the unit you have. As they level up, they just get better gear, and you get special points that you can spend to change them in a certain way or build them in a certain way. So you don't have to worry about weapons, you don't have to worry about items. You actually earn items through challenges and daily challenges. There's actually a daily challenge, I forgot to mention, where if you win certain matches, this is something I do like. There's a daily challenge match where if you win it, you basically get a new character, and it's a guaranteed new character. But it treats the game, but it treats the sortie as a big Fire Emblem match. Meaning if you lose a single unit, you fail the challenge. You can't have anybody die.
So, but is there permadeath when it comes down to these daily challenges? Because I know that's one thing Fire Emblem is good for.
There is no permadeath. You don't permanently lose your units in Fire Emblem Heroes. And you know what? From a mobile game with this design structure and this business model, I'm content with this. Because once again, every other match can still lead to an instance where your team gets wiped and you fail. But the daily challenges that are, you know, demands, you know, greater tactical thought will fail you the minute a single character dies. So that keeps in the spirit of the challenge of what Fire Emblem asks. So I'm fine with this.
Okay. Sounds fair enough. So Fire Emblem Heroes is free to play and sounds like it's doing pretty well.
It's actually doing a lot of stuff right. It's actually doing a lot of good stuff.
Yeah. It seems like Nintendo is getting to the stride of mobile gaming. So it's good to know that Fire Emblem Heroes at least keeps with the tradition of Fire Emblem while also making it accessible to people who probably wouldn't have picked up Fire Emblem in the first place.
Absolutely. And there's really not much else to say. It's a good time waster. I enjoy the content they have, and it does just enough to keep you on that treadmill without making it feel like you're grinding.
Yeah, there's one more thing. I've played a couple Fire Emblems in the past. Not a huge fan of it because, you know, I'm not gonna lie, it's been fun, but I'm not too big of a fan of Fire Emblem. The matches can take a while. So in Heroes, are the matches at least quick?
Each match I've played has only lasted maybe 5 minutes tops. That's about it.
So in other words, in a bus ride, you can get like 3 or 4 matches in and probably pick up some loot.
Oh yeah, no problem.
All right, well then.
Like I said, they kept it smaller but still engaging. For mobile, because there, you know, there's the 3DS games where you can just, you know, for hours upon hours, whatever, for these big matches. You do that on a mobile game, people are going to get turned off by that very quickly. They want something fast and digestible for a commute, as you mentioned.
Yeah, and that was one of my concerns with Fire Emblem, was like, are they going to mess it up by making the matches mobile length, like making it short, and will that ruin it, or would they make it too long and you end up with another Square Enix RPG overblown mobile game. But it's good to know that they actually found a way to balance it out.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good enough balance, you know, considering what they have. And once again, the free-to-play model stuff is good, and I do appreciate how they've handled the paywall. I mean, it's better than how they handled Super Mario Run, which is a story for another time. But I personally am enjoying what they've been doing with Fire Emblem Heroes. So, color me a big fan, and I have yet to actually buy any orbs, but the way things are going, I might just splurge at some point.
You know, I've always enjoyed free-to-play games like that, where you can play the game without spending money, but you do it anyway because you want to show support. I've done it a couple of times in mobile games. Like, I've beaten a whole game without spending a single penny, and I went back, created a new character, and bought unnecessary things just to speed up time because I like the game. I was like, you know what? You deserve this $5. Here you go, man. Take it. I don't even need these coins and orbs because I got plenty, but you know what? Take it. You deserve it. So I'm glad like that's the case for Heroes.
Oh yeah. So Michael, what exactly have you been doing?
Oh man, now that I've had my big move, I'm out of New York now.
We don't want to hear. We don't want to hear about your big move. Oh wait, you're talking about moving. I thought you were starting. I thought you were starting to brag about something like you know.
No.
I was going to see you in the world records or something.
Oh no, you're going to see me on. Local Channel 5 news, man goes crazy over stupid plot device and split. My co-host lied to me. He said it was a good twist. But actually, I've been doing a few coverage myself. If you guys haven't seen my SAG-AFTRA strike story, I got a chance.
Oh, that was a big one.
Yeah, I got a chance to do that before the end of last year. Had a great interview with Phil Lamar, cool guy, and
the always professional, and from what I could tell, one really cool person that is Phil Lamar.
Oh yeah, both. Like I was gonna ask him questions about Samurai Jack and his voice acting career. He got straight into the SAG-AFTRA strike and why they were doing it. I was like, oh man, he made me feel unprofessional for a second. Like, I was like, oh, man, I was trying to have a little bit of fun first, but you know what? Yeah, let's do this. Let's get straight into this.
No, that's fine. I mean...
No, I mean, it was good because that interview, even though the whole interview isn't in my report because it would have took a while, that alone, Lamar took up almost an hour with just talking to me and answering questions and just, like, straightforward. I was like, oh, well... You know, the video game industry is doing this. Why does the actors need this? And he was straightforward about it. If he didn't know something, he admitted he didn't know about it. If it was out of his reach, he would let you know. It's like, I can't answer that question because I don't know about it. That's for people above me or people who like know more about this stuff than me. But I can answer these questions. And so it was really great. Like, so if you guys take a listen to my SAG-AFTRA report and why the strike happened. I talked to, and it's not biased in any way, I talked to both a representative for the video game industry, and I talked to a representative for a SAG-AFTRA, which led me to Phil Lamar. So give a listen whenever you can.
That sounds actually a lot more professional than what I've been using my blog for in between my in between my obligations as features contributor to thegamefanatics.com.
I mean, I have plenty of free time since I don't have any editors to hold me back and tell me what I can and can't do.
Hey, man, I like my editors. Ben, hey. Ben, Charles, if you guys are listening to this, I love you. Please don't hurt me.
that's some editor love right there. Okay. But,
but they keep me in check. Sometimes I go on insane tangents, much like this podcast show sometimes.
Well, this is what this podcast is for us to be slightly unprofessional about things. We're professional yet unprofessional. We're unprofessionally professional. That's the way we do things, folks.
You're not even using real words anymore.
No, professional and unprofessional is a real word. You know, just oxymoron, put them together. But what's up?
Nothing. Oh. Go on.
Were you going to do another stupid little skit?
No.
Yes, you were.
Maybe.
Yeah. But for me, I've been doing some stuff on the side with comic books and video games. I've actually played two preview games before we started this recording. And oh my goodness, was one of them just not very good in the least professional way I can put this.
Which one are you talking about? I gotta hear this.
I'm talking about Conan Exiles.
Oh my gosh, it's the greatest realistic dick physics simulator ever. Man, I've heard so much about this.
You know what? And the sad part is, that's probably the most interesting part of this game. So I might as well start off with that.
The following part of this recording may be not safe for work, so if you don't like...
I don't think any of our stuff is safe for work.
So if you don't like, you know, very pronounced barbarian genitalia... in discussion or in visual representation. We haven't even got the images up for it yet. If you don't like any of that, please go away.
Don't go away.
For now.
Come back. Please don't go. We need all the viewers we can. Well, don't worry. We're not going to show any of it in the video because, you know, there's no point in doing that. So Conan Exiles is in early access right now. So you know what that means.
It's barely thought out concepts and half-hearted ideas.
Oh, man. It's to the fullest order. Okay, to be fair, the developers of Conan Exile sent me this extensive list. Actually, they sent it to all the journalists and people they were letting preview it. Mm-hmm. They sent out this extensive list of things that they're going to put into the game. So they let you know.
That's good.
Yeah, they let you know ahead of time that, hey, these are the issues you're going to run into. We're well aware of them. You know, this is stuff we're going to put in there. If this isn't working, this is why. Just, you know, take it easy on us. We're doing this because we want people to be interested in Conan Exile because it's early access. And from the way early access has been going, it's kind of hard to convince people like, hey, play another survival game on early access. We're different from everybody else. We promise.
Oh, please do go on. Try to convince me otherwise.
Conan Exile fails at that. It is another survival game. I don't know. I know.
There's way too many of them. There's such a thing as saturation in the market.
Yeah,
I 7 Days to Die, The Culling.
Yeah, The Culling.
Ark Survival Evolved.
The Culling actually does something interesting with their survival game by making like a competitor thingy going on. That was pretty interesting. I also did a video on that. I did some gameplay videos.
I'm also not fully crapping all over 7 Days to Die. I actually do think that has some potential, but. But you get the point, though. There's way too many of these on early access. I'm guessing this was a Steam key, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Of course. So that doesn't help either.
Right. Well, because it's early access, so they gave journalists and previewers a key in order to get in. And in fact, they even sent journalists a key ahead of time and gave us our own private server for a little while before the game actually became public early access.
Now that is actually really, really good on behalf of the developers, because I always find this annoying whenever certain publishers are like declare that they don't want game reviews out or review copies out because they want everybody to experience the same thing, and they don't think of, you know, having the forethought of just making, you know, reviewer oriented servers for the online features and have that put aside. I know it's a cost issue, but the coverage and the word of mouth you'd get, I think, would, you know, help, you know, cover that investment. But it sounds good that, you know, this studio is being, you know, very upfront with it. So that's very professional, especially for an early access title like that. So, bravo to that.
Yeah, they have confidence in this game, and they even put out there like, hey, we want you to stream it and talk about it and all this. It's like they really want to get the word out about this, and it's a double-edged sword because right now, Conan Exile,
the word of mouth is kind of bad.
Well, it has potential. It really does. From the list that they gave me, I kind of want to go back in and look for. I should have pulled this up ahead of time, but
I do enjoy that they're using the Conan the Barbarian license.
And you know what that bothers me about this survival game is that it feels like they're just using the license to be another survival game, but to have the advantage of, oh, it's Conan the Barbarian. You want to go around killing big beasts and surviving? Like, yeah, that sounds kind of cool. Because Conan would go around with his bare hands and pick up a stone rock and, like, bash somebody's face in.
But at the same time, though, like, survival elements in the Conan universe, that'd be kind of epic. Because it isn't just you becoming a king and turning it into Minecraft. It's like you have to get your sword. You have to go kill this minotaur that's raging around. Why? So you can save these people? No. So I can eat its flesh and take that treasure it has.
What do you mean save people?
You would, right?
You really think that's the way they would go with it? And they kind of do, but kind of don't. See, what happens is you don't even play Conan. You're playing a character that you create yourself. And yep. Conan randomly saves you from being on a cross for no reason whatsoever, just because, hey, I'm Conan.
You're being left down the middle of nowhere to die, and Conan comes in just like, you're free now.
Right. I mean, he even asked, it's probably it would be more merciful for me to leave you here to die, but he cuts you down anyway. He disappears.
Because Conan the Barbarian is kind of a jerk.
Oh yeah, the guy's a real dick. But yeah, I mean, but hey, look at the world he lives in. So
and look at the dicks in the world he lives in.
Oh man,
I know what I said.
It's so weird because you get started in the middle of nowhere, and the developers even said this is not story oriented. You can make up your own story, your own character, your own lore, but there are bits and pieces of Conan lore in there that you can find randomly.
They just haven't implemented it yet.
No, it's in there. Like some of it's in there. It's told through voiceovers when you pick up paper or find stone artifacts and whatnot. So it's not heavy. You can skip on all the lore and just make up your own stuff. It's really fun when you can make up your own stories. Problem is, the gameplay doesn't keep up with it because it does that same thing every survival game does.
You're barehanded. Go and punch something until you get material.
Yeah. All you're doing is going. You're picking up branches. You're picking up bugs. You're picking up fiber from leaves. You're crafting axes so you can chop down a tree to make more wood that you need for more axes. And you're making picks so that you can break more rocks so you can actually make a building. And it's just so boring. It started off interesting because you could hear these creatures in the background, and I'm thinking, oh man, there's gonna be something coming after me. I'm gonna die. So I quickly tried to make weapons. This is where an RPG element comes in. You can't just build anything. You actually have to learn recipes by leveling up.
How hard is it to learn how to make an axe? Well, it's a piece of stone and a piece of wood.
Well, some things are unlocked right from the get-go. Like you can make your axe and you can make your pick. But making shelter, learn the recipes. You want to make a sword? Learn the recipe, even though the sword is just a bigger axe, but whatever. You want to make a shrine? You gotta learn how to make a shrine if you pick a religion. You wanna make
some of that stuff
arrows.
Some of that stuff is understandable, but
it's fine. Like some of the bigger things that you try to make. Yeah, I get it. A stone wheel to break your enemies and NPCs and make them to your slaves. Yeah, okay. I understand you have to learn that kind of stuff. But oh man, the leveling system is really iffy. You're always gaining level. Even if you're just standing there, you're always gaining experience. So it's weird.
Strange.
Yeah, as long as you're surviving, like the game wants you to, as long as you're surviving,
you'll keep leveling up and getting experience.
Right.
There was actually one little preview I did see for Conan Exiles through my Twitter account. Be sure to follow me, by the way. And it was showing somebody like doing a screenshot of Conan Exiles, and it was showing how a kind of ludicrous some of the gamey elements of it. It was showing a screenshot of a guy punching another human character. And apparently it looked like he snuck on Bob and was getting ready to like punch him, and he was punching him in the buttocks. And it showed the contact of the fist in the buttock, and there was this unrealistic spurt of raspberry jelly looking blood that just came out of the buttock out of nowhere, and I just couldn't stop laughing of just how ludicrous it was.
And it comes up with the problem with the combat. The developers have mentioned that the combat is still being tweaked, still being worked on. But it's so weird. I got attacked by this random thing that came out of nowhere. Scared the living daylights out of me, by the way. I'll give the sound designers that. The sound design is good. All right.
Okay.
If something's in the background, yeah, it sounds like it's in the background. You don't know where it is, and you're scared because it's night and it's dark. And man, I made it sound kind of cool, which. My first impression was this is actually kind of cool because it was dark. I know where I was because I'm in the middle of nowhere. I'm low on materials and I'm hearing this thing in the background and I'm not sure if it's going to run up on me and eat me while I'm trying to build this house and this fire pit. So it was kind of cool at first until you realize, no, it's just sound in the background.
That's a shame because it sounds like they took some cues from whoever worked on the sound design for Resident Evil 7 and then didn't really do enough follow through, like attributed to creature AI or something. Once again, this is early access, work in progress. This is just a bit of a disappointment of the game in its current state.
Oh, very. And the combat, you think, oh, I have a pickaxe, I can hit people with it. No, I was trying to kill this thing that attacked me out of nowhere, and I was trying to hit him with my pickaxe. I'm thinking, oh, the hit detection isn't working. And when I respawned, I made a sword and went after that same, I don't know, it was the same looking creature. And I was able to hit him, no problem. I was like, so you mean to tell me I can't kill people with an axe?
A pickaxe is only a tool, not a weapon. That is so not barbarian fantasy. Yeah, it makes my head hurt.
Yeah, it kind of breaks the whole immersion, because you're thinking, oh, I'm low on material. My pickaxe is going to break, but I'm going to use it to defend myself.
You're in this epic, huge fantasy of, you know, Boris Vallejo artistry and, you know, swords and sorcery nonsense, and yet for some reason it isn't proper to kill a snake monster with a pick.
But again, they did say that the combat was still being worked on, so maybe future patches...
Maybe they haven't worked on, you know, proper attack and metrics and implementation for a pickaxe or more artisanal tools and the like. So, I can sort of understand... It sounds like I understand where they're coming from when it comes to their focus, but... It is a bit of a shame that this is your first impressions, because these do die hard.
I mean, I will admit this. It wasn't all bad. Like I said, the sound design is good. The technical aspect, of course, is still being worked on. Frame rate is a huge issue right now.
Oh, dear.
I saw these things trying to run after me, and they were running in place. It didn't skip a few beats, and it kind of like a bad, like, just bad framework all around. Until they got to a certain point, and then the animation smoothed out, and you could see them actually running towards you rather than in place and then popping in different parts. The AI is ridiculously stupid. It's really weird. And trying to go back to something good. The day-night cycles is a cool idea. If you don't have fire, you're not going to be able to see anything. It's wonderful in a way, because when it first got dark, I thought there was something wrong with my screen, and I had to put up the gamma, but no, instead I made fire. Luckily, I didn't raise my gamma, I just made fire instead. And that's when I noticed that, wow, when it actually gets dark out here, it really gets dark. Like
it feels like you really are out in the middle of nowhere with no light source whatsoever.
Right, yeah. Yeah, and I'd never noticed that, and I was like, wow, you know, this is actually really good. When the sun is out, you can see everything. Like, because of the graphics card I have and processing and all that other nonsense, with my gaming PC, I can run this game at its highest peak for right now. And the draw distance is nice. It's actually some pretty good draw distance, other than the animation and some of the characters in the background. But the draw distance is nice, and you can actually see where you're going. And you can see, like, towers and buildings far, far away. And you can look at it and be like, that's where I want to go, and go towards it. So the draw system is great. So the lighting in the daytime and the lack of lighting at nighttime, unless you have a torch, is great. They got that down pat right now. So it looks like a completed game. Graphics are a little muddy, you know, that can still be worked on.
Yay.
It's just, there's so many stuff around trying to kill you. I was trying to build a house, and I got attacked by this alligator thing. That's what I get for trying to build a house near water. Yeah, the music is great. The music hits on cue, so you get the barbaric music. It's good lighting. The sound design is great, but other than that, the combat's not that great. The survival elements is stupid, even though the RPG element they put in there could help balance it out. Because again, you have to watch after your health, watch after your energy, watch after your thirst and your hunger. But luckily, the game gives you...
Coden, what is best in life? Making sure I stay well-fed and...
well-hydrated.
Well-hydrated.
I gotta stay hydrated. But they give you RPG elements to raise your strength, raise your dexterity, and your metabolism. So you can actually process food slower and slow down your hunger meter from depleting.
That's good.
Yeah, so it brings in some interesting elements. It's just too bad... When you level up, you never have enough points for any of that stuff. So I've died of starvation so many times because a handful of bugs does not feed you.
Once again, the work in progress. They'll probably iron that out. Because I remember playing an early build of We Happy Few. I remember the hunger and thirst mechanic in that was so freaking out of whack. It was practically unplayable.
element.
They've worked on that now, so right. You know.
Well, Conan Exile, it deals with that. It's not as bad. It takes a while for you to die of thirst and starvation. So it's not like, oh, it's instant death, or like, oh, my meter's out after 10 minutes being in this desert. No, I ran around for a while before it's like, hey, man, you're starving to death. Like, oh, what? Oh, yeah, that's right. This element is part of the game.
So, oh, yeah, right. People need food to live.
Yeah. Silly me. So I went around trying. Oh, it's also another thing. You have to hunt food. I couldn't kill my animal thingy with my axe, but I could kill it with a sword. So that was cool. Yay. But is Conan Exile worth your early access money right now? No. I hate to say
how much is it actually asking for? Do you know how much it is to get into this early access extravaganza?
You know, forgot. Hold on. I'll have to look it up.
Professionalism, folks.
Well, the thing is, I didn't really care what the price was because it's not worth it. Because there's also a Barbarian Edition. And
oh dear lord, no.
Yeah, they're doing that thing to where there's a thing where you can buy the early access and you can upgrade to a better one. It's look, people, it's weird, okay? It's not worth the time. It's not worth the money right now.
In its current state, don't bother.
Yeah, it needs a little bit of time. I hate saying that because I can see where they're going with this.
You see the potential, and that is always painful to see and not realized. That's always a thing that I wish people understood more when it came to certain critics being harsh on certain games. At best case scenarios, critics usually don't like being this harsh or this down on a game. Some of them, oh,
especially for a game that's in early access, because it gives away a bad impression, and it's not because, oh, I want the developers to like me. It's more just, I can see where this is going, and this is kind of unfair. Even though
this could have been amazing. However, it's blank.
Yeah, now it's not worth it. So it's like $30 just for the standard edition. It's not worth the $30.
That is a bit steep for how you're describing the current build. So
yeah, it's not worth it. And hold on, let me see if I can find this Barbarian Edition. Yeah, the Barbarian Edition is $60.
You're serious.
But luckily, it comes with the Barbarian Edition comes with a bunch of stuff. It comes with the game, a digital comic. Apparently, the Conan Exile game has a comic book. I guess this one actually deals with Conan. It comes with Conan the Avenger comic book, 6 of them. It comes with the Coming of Conan ebook, a 400-page book.
So a bunch of Conan the Barbarian peripherals,
right?
And a bunch of other, you know, Conan the Barbarian merch.
Yeah, and you get a Conan Exiles T-shirt, a real T-shirt, not digital.
I'm sorry, that'd be kind of weird. You start your build of Conan Exiles in this Conan world, and there's like a T-shirt over you. T-shirt over you says like Arnie was the best. Forget Momoa or something.
To be fair, the game actually allows you to make clothing and armor and whatnot.
I'm not that surprised. It's kind of standard. But so far, the Barbarian Edition is basically you get the game and a bunch of Conan the Barbarian exclusive merchandise.
Yeah, it's a bunch of knickknacks, and it's like the sad thing is that $60 is probably worth it more because you get all that stuff if you're a Conan fan. Because hey, I get a T-shirt, some stuff for the Age of Conan MMO. You get digital books. And,
I'm actually amazed Age of Conan is still going.
You know, I forgot that was even a thing. to be honest, I forgot that was even a thing.
It's amazing how certain MMOs keep going for so long. But so okay, bunch of Conan the Barbarian merchandise stuff. If you get this, not entirely ready yet, work in progress at double its asking price.
Another good thing I can say about it didn't crash. The game ran. The game never crashed on me, even though it did have.
Oh,
okay. Since it's working on servers, there were some server issues, which the developers admitted. Like, yeah, there were server issues. And I played both single player, and I'm doing air quotes here, people. And I did the multiplayer. They both run on servers. there's something wrong with the server. Things are kind of wonky. I've had enemies kind of disappear on me because the server went. Oh, I've also had trouble collecting items because the server would mess up while I was picking up branches and rocks, and it wouldn't, and it stopped registering that I picked up boulders and I picked up branches and rocks. So the servers are a little iffy. So that's gonna cause some problems when the game actually releases and more people get on these servers. But at the same time, you can also run your own servers. So, you know.
Oh, that's actually a good feature. So having servers isn't tied directly to the studio, so there's not going to be some future where they'll just shut the servers down and the game basically dies.
Let's hope not. Because the game also gives you a chance to download and install an anti-cheat software, which I didn't do because I don't really care about that anyway. But you can play the game without installing the anti-cheat software. You can even play the multiplayer without it. So it gives you a choice. It doesn't force you to download this anti-cheat software. It's, hey, here's what we do with your data. Here's how it works.
It isn't a form of DRM.
It's an actual anti-cheat thing for the multiplayer section. But that's fine. Yeah, you also do the multiplayer without it. But it's letting you know, hey, this is why we implemented this. You can forego it and you can play the game all you want the way you want. But if you think that there might be cheaters out there, which let's face it, it's an online game, there's always going to be somebody out there hacking and cheating. This is software for it, and it gives you a chance to install it whenever you want. It lets you know the first time, hey, this is a thing. If you say no, it doesn't pop back up. It doesn't bother you. It's one and done, and whenever you start up your Steam, it gives you the option to play the game without it, and I'm fine with that. This has got to be the least intrusive anti-cheat software that I've ever seen. It's upfront about it.
That's good. So any other thoughts on Conan Exiles before we move on to the other beta you may have played?
Just wait. It's not ready yet. Just wait.
Just wait. Get a bit more time. Let them put a bit more polish into it. Okay.
Yeah. Keep watching streams about it. Keep up with it because it's interesting. It is interesting. All the stuff that they put on the list that they gave journalists, and that they were going to implement in the game. They got some big ideas. The list is not short. Like they know they're focused. They know what they want to do. But right now, the game isn't there yet.
And they want that very constructive player feedback from having this in early access to help tweak and refine their systems.
Yeah.
Which is understandable. That's actually a good implementation of this early access model. And it sounds like these are professional developers that are proactive with this information. So that's good.
Yeah, so they've been very open about it. So I'm going to keep my eyes on it, even though I'm not huge when it comes to survival games. This has some promise to it, especially since you can choose if you want to do player versus player or player versus environments and have a clan and have you and your friends go up against the environment. That's kind of fun. It's an interesting idea.
Have your cabal of other rough and tumble types that survived death in facing this brutal world by the glory of Crom. And stuff, and you know, I can actually groove on that. When it gets going.
Yeah, there's actually an option called role playing where you can just ignore everything, the stories and all that,
and just get into the character of this, this meat man you are controlling. This beefcake meat man.
Hey, it could be a woman too.
It's a lot of fun.
Well, it's a fun idea. So, it's not ready yet. Not worth the $30. Surely it's not worth the $60 yet. So just keep watching.
Unless you have some weird fascination with well rendered genitalia, I guess.
Hey, the developers also say they want to implement castration into the game. So, yeah. Hey, they're going full barbaric. Like I said, they know what they want to do with this. They're focused. So just it's now just wait and see how it goes for the rest of the month. There's one more thing before we move on. The developers mentioned, and it's important that I say this. The developers mentioned that they do not expect Conan Exiles to be in early access no more than 12 months.
That's good. They have a timetable. Yeah, that is very professional.
Yeah, yeah. They actually they 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 don't have an exact date of when they'll finish it, but they do not expect to be in early access more than 12 months. So for the rest of this year, just keep your eyes open on it.
Good to know. And that is Conan Exiles. Still a work in progress. So, okay, good. All right, so what is the other beta preview you have had the privilege of experiencing, Michael?
Sniper Ghost Warrior 3. Not to be confused with Sniper Elite. It's actually a different sniper game. You know, it's tough to talk about this one because it was open beta. It was a weekend beta kind of thing where I don't even know how they gave out keys for this. But they were pretty open about it. They let people try out the game. It's a two-level demo, which, to be honest, I couldn't tell you which mission was which because the story is kind of dumb. I don't know what's going on.
You're a trained sniper to shoot all the bad guys to help with freedom for America.
The thing is, you know, it's you're in the Middle. I'm pretty sure it's the Middle East. You're not shooting any Afghans, by the way. You're shooting other people. I don't know. The game didn't really go into who exactly you're going against.
You're in a vaguely exotic location. Go shoot people.
Yeah. So the game is actually fun. I'm actually looking forward to Sniper Ghost Warrior 3. I don't know why, but this two-level demo was more than enough to wet my palate to make me think, like, man, I really want to play this game right now. Yeah. It did well because it does what other games try to do with open world, but doesn't really do well. It doesn't make it too open. It has an actual set limit. And not only that, but it gives you enough tools to play around with to where each mission can feel slightly different. You can actually strategize and go into each mission with a different set of eyes, different plan. Even if you play the same mission 2-3 times, you can still go in there and change up how you actually do things and how you actually strategize each approach. So
that's perfectly fine. Like,
it's great. The big thing is the drone, of course, which I abuse that little drone. I use that every second I got. You can use the drone to find, mark, and tag enemies. There's also a bullet where you can tag enemies, but I didn't use it because I had my drone. So whatever.
Why would I need that?
Right. Yeah. Like, that's a waste of a bullet. So in the demo, the drone is a big part of a big feature, and it's how can I put this? You remember in the first Batman Arkham game where his sonic powers, where he was able to see everything around him, was a little overpowered?
Oh, that detective vision he had.
Yeah, his detective vision.
Yeah,
the drone's the same way. That thing is. The only thing about the drone that sucks is not even that the battery goes out, because it recharges when you call it back. You can only carry one unless you upgrade your abilities to carry two for some odd reason. And it can be easily spotted, which is a good thing, because I don't know, for people who never use drones, those things are not silent. Those things are pretty loud. So it can be easily detected.
It's a good call.
Yeah. And the camera on the drone is not the best.
Limited field of vision, limited sight.
Well, not even that. Like, you can see a lot. Like, with a drone, I own a drone, and it's cool how much you can see with that tiny camera. But when you zoom in, that's when things start to deteriorate. And the drone in this game, you could zoom in, and it is so messed up because you could zoom in as much as you want and look at a character, it won't tag that character unless you're close enough to them. And
what?
It's really weird. It's like, I can see him perfectly. Why can I not press a button and tag him? But instead, you have to get close. And when you move that drone while zoomed in, the camera just messes up like a real drone does when it's zoomed in, because it's on a swivel. And you have to wrestle with the controls in order to get that drone to do what you want. So,
oh, that sounds like a headache.
a bit. When you first play it, it is jarring because you're like, oh, I'm just going to zoom in and mark. Nope. Okay, well, while I'm zoomed in, I'll just move a little closer. Zoomed in, the camera just goes somewhere else. You're like, oh, you're that kind of camera. Okay. So I'm constantly zooming in and out while I'm moving this stupid thing. Battery.
Yeah, that sounds like a pain.
Yeah, battery life is actually pretty good. It drains quickly like any real drone does. It can be easily spotted, like I said. And
is this like a major part of these levels? Like, do they encourage you to scout with this drone?
Oh my goodness, yes. You, if you, I mean, you don't have to. It gives you the choice. But if you don't, you're just asking for trouble.
You're a sniper. It kind of goes into that power fulfillment of being this tactician, this recon guy. So
right,
that's good.
Right, and so there's one level where I had to break into a compound and assassinate some higher up. Well, I drive up to the front of the building, and it's heavily guarded. I'm like, more than a dozen guys around there, and I'm like, wow, they are not messing around with this compound. It's not like Splinter Cell with his three or four dudes per room. No, like they're staying in contact. They're walking around. They're doing their shifts. So you have to actually sit there and watch their movements. And you have to watch everybody's movements to see who moves, who doesn't, who moves where.
Like an actual sniper in enemy territory would have to do.
Yeah, because sometimes they'll walk up to each other and talk and separate. Other times they'll just walk past each other. There are times where people will sit down and stay in a certain spot. People who will actually march back and forth towards not even small sections. Like, they actually do routes.
So there's actual, like, patrols you can figure out.
Yeah.
And there's actual, okay, that's good. Okay, you brought the comparisons to the Sniper Elite games. Is there a mission where you can shoot Hitler?
I don't know. Not in a demo. Not in this beta, you can't.
I bring this up because I know the Sniper Elite games always sell as a pre-order bonus for their games a mission where you get to assassinate Adolf Hitler.
Yeah, it's like, how many times do you have to kill Hitler? Like, geez, man. Yeah.
They always find a way to put some spin on the kill Hitler pre-order mission, and I think that's actually how the Sniper Elite games become so popular, but Sniper Ghost Warrior sounds like it doesn't get nearly as much love as it should, and it sounds like your first impressions of this. I'm assuming you haven't played any of the prior ones of the Sniper Ghost Warrior games.
No, I've never really played them. I never played Sniper Elite either. So there's that.
It sounds like Sniper Ghost Warrior has some gas in the tank, a bit of underappreciation going forward right now.
Oh, it's great because there's actual bullet drop. Where I was in the army for a little while, so I understood.
Okay, so they really do adhere to military realism, as you said, for
slightly
a bullet drop, wind shear, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
Okay.
It does all that. And it's great because I was actually able to, he's this far, he's 200 meters away. I already know how bullet drops works and all that nonsense, the speed of sound and all that.
Yep.
So I was able to figure out quite easily how and who I can take out and how far it was and this and that. But, what's also fun is you could bring a sidearm and a secondary weapon.
Just in case you're spotted or whatever.
Oh, yeah. And you could put silencer on your sniper, of course, and your pistol. And here's what really impressed me about the game is the silencer isn't silent like it is in video games. If you shoot that thing close enough to an enemy, they will hear it. And I like that because usually when you play a game, you could shoot somebody in the face with a silencer and his partner's like 3 feet away and couldn't hear it. That's not how silencers work.
Huh, must have been a bird.
Yeah, it's like, oh, what was that? Chirp. Okay, it's just another birdie.
I'm also going to assume the suppressors basically break down after like a couple of shots.
Yes, yeah, it starts to overheat and it'll break down. But you also get repair kits where you can repair your sniper rifle. And your
sounds sounds like wow. Sounds like it has the verisimilitude of the sniper empowerment fantasy going for it. I don't want to say realism.
It's not realistic, but it definitely has that fantasy going for it. And
it sounds like it has the verisimilitude downright as to you know, an approximation of a real life feel of it.
It's still pretty video gamey, which is fine. I'm fine with that. But when you start a new mission, your stuff doesn't replenish. I found that out the hard way. I brought a new sniper rifle with me after one of my missions to start a second one, and I noticed my silencer was still halfway done. I was like, well,
how about that?
Yeah, probably should replace that. I was kind of hoping, since I got a new sniper rifle, that I will also replace the silencer. Nope, same with my pistol. Both silencers were being used up, and I was like, well then, I guess I'm going in half cocked. But the missions are varied. Well, from the demo, there's a secondary mission where you have to, again, like I said, I was supposed to assassinate a higher up, but there was also a drone that was optional for me to find and pick up. And I was like, oh, well, that's kind of cool. So I went around picking off people, finding secrets, and I died, because one of the problems with this game was it's still a little glitchy, still a little buggy. It allows you to climb on and down certain things. And, well, one of the things I was allowed to climb down, it wouldn't let me down. So I end up having so I end up falling off, and I die.
Ah. Oh, dear me.
And that's when I found out, when you die, every enemy that you've killed, no matter what checkpoint you're on, they all respawn.
Oh.
Every last enemy.
Patience. Planning, wow, that's good. That's actually a really, once again, reinforcing the verisimilitude of the experience in these terms. That's good.
I was so mad about that, though, because I was almost done with the mission. I was on the last objective, and I died, and I came back, and every enemy I've ever tagged instantly popped back on the screen. I was like, what the hell is that? I look over. Everybody's back on their routes. I was like, are you serious?
Son of a gun.
How much was it? I am not shooting my way out of this. Which, I do not recommend going into a shootout with these people. You can barely take a bullet.
You have a pistol. They have an assault rifle.
Well, I mean, I brought an AK with me, so I know. Uh-oh. I was able to mow a few of them down. But enemies you don't have tagged have some of the most silent footsteps I've ever heard in a video game. Like, I end up getting shot in the back from an enemy I didn't know was on patrol, and walked up behind me from another room. And by the time I turned around and noticed he was there, he
already surprise, Mother Russia.
Pretty much.
And we're trying to keep the show clean, folks.
Right. And unlike most games where, oh, you've been spotted and you try to hide and it dies down and they go back on the routes. Nope, not in this. They stay on alert the whole time. If you get spotted once,
they don't just default. This isn't Splinter Cell. This isn't Metal Gear. You're spotted. Everybody knows you're there. They're going to hunt for you.
Yeah, and it's not one of those, oh, he must have left and go back on their route. Nope. Instead, they'd be like, you think he's still there? Keep your head down, sniper. And like, gosh darn it. So. Yeah, getting caught has its repercussions. They know you're there. They're going to stay on guard. If you pop up, they're going to chase you down. So, Sniper Ghost Warrior 3 has bite to it. It's actually pretty fun from the beta. The tools of destruction that you have are fun. And it's not just, hey, you have to stay silent. The game doesn't mind if you're the type who wants to go in guns blazing. It will let you do that. It gives you C4, gas grenades, flashbangs, regular grenades. It gives you gas mines. You can create little mines to set traps. You can create sounds to distract or to lure enemies. You can knife enemies down. You can
sound. The usual repertoire of gadgets that's usually attributed to stealth games.
Yeah, like they give you the options. You want to do stealth, you can do stealth. You want to go in guns blazing Call of Duty, go right ahead. You can do that, although we don't recommend it because you'll probably get shot down within like 2 minutes.
Go for it, and good luck to you, maniac.
Yeah, so people who want to speed run, they can just go in, blaze everybody out, and be done with it. Heck, you don't even have to kill everybody in level. I could I took out a sniper.
You just had to finish your mission.
Oh yeah, yeah. I took out a sniper and then my target, and it was like, "All right, good job. Get out of there." It's like, "Oh. Okay, cool. Well, I'm going to look for this drone anyway." And went and got the drone awesome. And left. So, it's fun in the sense that it gives you options, and the open world is not this massive open sandbox. It actually gives you enough room to plan, to recon.
Sounds like they give you just enough to have enough content there. Like, it almost reminds me of the size of the map that they used for the Metal Gear Ground Zeroes. Like, it wasn't a huge thing, but there was just enough stuff in that area that had plenty of content and mileage out of it. Is that an appropriate comparison?
You know what? Yeah, I would say it is, because it gives you enough road to drive on. It gives you plenty of areas to set up a sniper's nest. Like, it's not just one set place that you can move around and stealth your way through. And you can go, and it's not like there's one path. No, it's like, well, there's a sniper nest up here you can have. We suggest you going on this ceiling, on this rooftop. We suggest you take this road, and you can actually hide in foliage. So you can see, there's plenty of ways you can sneak around. So Sniper Ghost Warrior, man, I'm excited for it. It's pretty good.
That's a very pleasant surprise.
Oh yeah, I wish it was an actual trial, so people who hear this can actually go out and try it now, and it wasn't just a weekend thing, because it's actually pretty fun. Now, the bugs I was talking about, there was a moment where I tried to switch out my rifle with my pistol, and the game had a problem remembering that I don't have my default weapons, that I changed those out, and for some reason it went back to my default weapons, and I had to cycle through until it is like, oh, that's right, you got a new rifle, here you go. And I was like, oh, that's really dumb. So I thought, oh, I brought both rifles with me. No, you can only carry one.
The heck?
Yeah, so some weird...
Sounds like a head scratcher.
Yeah, it's some weird bugs. And the worst part is, my default weapon acted like the default weapon. It didn't act like the new weapon I got. So it wasn't just messed up skin, texture or skin. No, it was the actual rifle.
We actually forgot that you actually got a different rifle. Here's this other rifle.
Yeah, here's your default, because I forgot that you got a new rifle, a new sidearm, and a new secondary.
That would drive me up the wall.
Oh man, it almost made me mad, because I had a great shot on a guy, but the default rifle you have doesn't allow you to zoom in, and I wasn't going to try to guess the windage with this certain rifle.
Don't try to be the White Death. You're not going to be the White Death.
Yeah. Like, I picked that other rifle for a reason, because I was far out and it allowed me to do an 8-16. An 8-16 zoom. And I needed that 16. And I was like, wait, why am I using this rifle that's like a times 4, 8? That doesn't make any sense. And I thought I messed up, but no, it was the game. So it's still a little buggy, but I'm pretty sure that'll get fixed by the time the game actually releases.
Jeez. All right.
Other than that, it was great. I enjoyed myself.
All right. So, anything else you want to discuss that you have brought to the podcast show's attention?
There's actually only one more thing, and it is not even video game related. It is actually a comic book.
Well, considering the opening gag with Split and the fact that I've debased myself into basically writing fan fiction as part of my Monday posts on the cybertavern.blogspot.com, please read, check it out. It's actually pretty good. I don't think I can say I'm above you when I say we can't have comic books here. So please discuss.
Valentine's Day is upon us, ladies and gentlemen. It's coming. It's that time of year again where we're all alone and we don't know why this is even a day to celebrate.
Dude, I have some contention with that, because my birthday is around the same time. So it's kind of a fun way to kind of project my ego on this. Like, it's my birthday and everybody in the world is celebrating by being loving towards each other, because I am truly a gift.
Oh my goodness. I thought I was bad. That's horrible.
I'm so lonely.
Aren't we all? Oh, jeez. That's not true, people. We all have stuff. I have my amiibos. Yeah, I got my amiibos.
I got my amiibos too.
My Squid Sister amiibos and my Nick Wilde and Judy Hopps figures. Yeah.
Oh, I got my Tracer figurine over there.
Lucky, I've been looking for Tracer. But back on subject.
Back to the comics.
But yes.
Do this to us.
Valentine's Day is upon us. And with it comes comic books. Everybody knows that superheroes don't make for the best comic book lovers. Just look at Superman and Wonder Woman. Or Wonder Woman and Batman.
Or Wonder Woman and Batman, I think. I really do think Wonder Woman and Batman holds more water, but that's me.
Yeah, I was going to say also Green Lantern and Hot Girl. But, you know. Whatever, man. DC really does love their shipping. Oh well. Anyhow,
I still think Captain Marvel and Spider-Man would have made it work. But moving on.
Yes. Have you ever heard of a comic called Empowered?
Actually, I haven't really been into comics for a while. I kind of stopped some around the time the Dark Reign event and Marvel happened, and the whole Batman Reborn thing was a total cop out to Batman dying in Final Crisis. No, I'm not gonna buy that he became a time traveler from being hit with the convolutedness of comics. Kind of stopped me for a while, and I just kind of said no to superheroes comics, which is a big sell for comic books, and not even manga. For some reason, this, you know, the sequential art form of comic books and manga, I just stopped. Like, you know, I'm done. No, I can't deal with this. You know, I got other things to deal with. So honestly, it's no surprise I've not heard of this comic called Empowered. So please tell me about it.
Well, I too am not 100% sure on Empowered. Yes, I do know of it, and what I can tell you from what I do know, it's a bit of a jab at superheroes and manga in a way. It takes all these colorful, eccentric heroes and actually puts them in this city. It's a comic that's well aware of what it is and what it's trying to do, and you have a character. You have this blonde character named Empowered. She wears this skin tight outfit that always, some reason, have like tears in them in some of the most strategic places. And every time she puts on her costume, it's in a new area. I think it's part of the joke. And she's
look at all the skin tight leather. This is look hot and
oh yeah,
dang it!
And it's not just her. It's like every superhero has this weird costume esque going on. Like dudes with like super tight uniforms on, to where they turn around, you can see the perfectly shaped buttocks. She has a friend who carries around a katana and like this really skimpy outfit. It's really weird. There's robots, there's dragon heroes, cosmic heroes, it's villains. It
sounds almost like it's kind of a love letter, like the Silver Age and insanity of comics, which I do like, by the way, and also kind of poking some holes in some of the aesthetic decisions, like I mentioned, where the tears and the costume.
There's a hero who's a mummy, and there's another one that's like this toxic glob thing. Like, think of muck, only like gassy bubbles. It's yeah, it's really weird. But anyway, so Empowered takes place in this city filled with heroes and villains. And in this new comic called Empowered and the Soldier of Love, there's something going around where all the heroes start falling for each other. Man and man, women and women, women and man, weird glob toxic things and other people. So
oh, gosh.
Yeah, human or not, doesn't matter. Dragons and dragons, robot, even the robots fall in love with each other and other people and stuff.
Oh my gosh, I'm sorry, I just keep seeing like Zoidberg from Futurama just getting into all this. I am so into you.
From the way this comic started off, now even Zoidberg have some luck going on over here. So it all starts off with these heroes falling in love randomly. Like, everybody's getting with each other. And come to find out that it's not natural. That they're just not falling in love naturally. Like, it's just random. Some people fall in love the night they meet, some the day after. And this comic isn't for kids. It's not raunchy.
Sounds like it.
Yeah, it's not raunchy. Like, they swear a bit, but it blanks itself out for comedic reasons. Like, there's gotcha. Like, there's a joke where the team is like, oh, it's time to go to action. So they go towards the team's vehicle, but it's rocking back and forth. And and the boss is like, oh, well, there's an unwritten rule. If the van's a knocking, if the van's rocking, you don't come a knocking. So, so instead of disturbing his team, who's getting it on inside the team's vehicle, he's like, well,
let him finish and we'll
get to- Yeah, he's like, well, we'll find another way to get to saving the day. It's like, wow, you guys got some real priority going on. But the comic itself.
Okay, so the conceit is people start falling in love. They found out it's not natural. And I'm guessing that has something to do with the titular soldier of love.
Yes. So there's this. I want to say she's Spanish. She's speaking Spanish. But this pink haired, dragon carrying M4 packing. I don't know what she's smoking, but it's like. It's not. It kind of looks like a vape, but it's not. And she's wearing this like Sailor Moon esque frilly dress.
Sailor Scout outfit.
It's so weird. It's hard to discuss this. But she looks.
Sounds completely gonzo.
Oh my goodness! It is
crazy.
It is so fun to read because she looks like this. Girl Scout leader, but she also looks like a mercenary, and she has this pink dragon that can float around with her, and it apparently plays her background music for her, and
Rob Liefeld is saying dang right now.
Yeah, and it's not like it's silent. Like, even some of the characters are like, do you hear music in the background? And you come to find out it's this little dragon playing it, and it's weird. Anyway, so the main part of the story is when all these heroes start falling in love, some of them cause damage. Like, there's these two heroes that has cosmic powers, one fire, one ice, and you think they're going to start fighting each other. Instead, they start making out and they start creating storms and earthquakes and all kinds of unnatural disasters.
Whoops.
Yeah, right? It's like, oh, your superpowers are kind of screwing everything up right now. So it's up to our titular hero in power, her friend, and the one or two people who have yet to be affected by this whole strange love conundrum to find out what's going on and how to stop it.
Oh my god, who's the publisher? Dynamite?
Oh no, Image? Dark Horse.
That makes sense. This does seem like something that would definitely be pitched and published by Dark Horse Comics.
And you know what? I love it. It's a three-part series. Okay. Part one hasn't come out yet. This is actually what I'm reviewing right now. I'm reviewing part one of three.
Okay.
It ends on a pretty neat cliffhanger because we don't know anything about the Soldier of Love. And there are parts in the comic where she speaks full-blown Spanish, and I wasn't going to go through Google to figure out what she was saying. So
Google Translate's also tenuous at best, so I think it'd be better not to do that.
Yeah, so, you know, it'd be lost in translation anyway. Even her little pink dragon speaks in Spanish. But the Soldier Love, she also speaks English, so she's bilingual.
Okay.
We kind of... I can't talk about it too much because the comic does a great job of keeping things...
Say no more. This is actually a great hook. This actually sounds something I would actually, you know, get a kick out of if I read. And that's saying something, because the last time I even heard about a comic event that actually got me interested was the announced Mighty Morphin Power Rangers Justice League crossover. Apparently, that's happening.
Yeah, that's going to be a thing. Has it happened yet? Or is it still?
I don't know. I saw some promo art for it. I'm like, that is so dumb, and I want to read it. But other than that, I've been kind of very mum as the goings on comics, but empowered, this actually sounds, it sounds lovingly silly.
Oh, it is bright colored. It's not one of those monotones. Oh no, everything is dark and gritty. No,
this is not 90s Iron Age. This is very clearly Silver Age inspired, almost Golden Age inspired, the way you're making it sound. It is out there. It is crazy. It is silly, like comic book superheroes usually are. It's a fact. People stop ignoring it, and I'm fine with that.
Yeah, and it's great because these heroes, they drink, they smoke, they go to bars.
But it isn't to a level of adolescent excess, like, oh, no. Oh, life's hard, smoke.
No, it's nothing like bad. It's just like they make it modern. It's these heroes living among civilians, and they have this thing called cape night where they go, everybody's in their costumes, and they're singing karaoke and then drinking and all this other stuff. They're having fun. The comic takes time to show that, hey, these people live lives. Like, it's not all doom and gloom.
It is just dedication to truth, justice, and peace, and all those big, you know, paragon-type things. I'm fine with that.
Yeah, and it owns up to what it is. Goofy, colorful, superhero fun.
And sincere. It sounds like it's very sincere.
You know, it doesn't take itself too seriously. It's great, and, you know, I want to see more of this. I have a couple of volumes of Empowered that I never got around to. I'm sorry about that. I should have read it. So now I'm going to go back and look at those, because this is people, I want to talk about it more. I really do. I feel like I want to do a spoiler talk for it.
It sounds like more would be said by saying less. You actually have made me interested. We're just discussing about it normally, man.
Oh yeah. Like, the less you talk about it, the more interesting it is, because the comic does a good job of keeping things mysterious. It doesn't go into this overly complicated background for the Soldier of Love. It introduces her, shows that she's openly, it's like, hey, she's the reason for it. There's no point in being who's this big, mysterious...
Concise world building and storytelling.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah, and it does well, because the biggest mystery is how it's affecting everybody, and I'm having a great time with. I had a great time with this. That I really wish it was more than just three, because there is a scene, like I said, with the heroes that were getting together, where Empowered and her friend goes on this shipping fanfic kind of discussion when they see these two heroes go at it, and no joke. Empower, squeeze. She squeeze, and you see all these little hearts come around her while she's blushing in uniform because of these two characters that she oh, what was it? She even said, I would totally ship this if it weren't actually effing happening right now. Squeeze.
Tumblr is going to enjoy this comic so hard.
They keep it modern. Like, it's not like it's super goofy superhero modern fun. And you know what, like you said, you fall out of comics. I fell out of them for a little while too, because of the whole stupid little art thing. This is good.
Four
out of five. Read it. It's a good start, and you don't even need to know about Empower to enjoy it.
It's a superhero universe. Jump in. Say no more.
Yeah, and if you could find the older stories, I'm going back to look for them. It's good. I enjoyed it.
All right, then. Not much else that really can be said, then. So, not much else that's coming out currently as of recording. Like, for references, people, Neo, the PlayStation 4 exclusive action RPG by Team Ninja, it hasn't come out just yet. It's coming out tomorrow, so hopefully we're gonna have time to discuss maybe that in the future later on, and probably some other stuff as well. So wrapping up for our premiere episode of season 2 of That Random Podcast Show, Michael, where can we find you?
You can of course find me on Twitter at M_MOSLEY. And if for some reason you can't find me on there, you can find me with Zafmod, ZAFMOD. And I even have my own blog now. I finally started that thing up that I kept talking and I was going to do. Finally happened. Blog is Zafmod. You can find it in the description below. And of course, you can blame Mr. Chancey for that happening.
You're welcome. As mentioned before, you can follow me at Twitter, on Twitter at DarthRahu, capital D as in Darth Vader, R-A-H-U, all one word. And, of course, since I have basically badgered Michael into having his own blog, and I have my own continuation of posts with cybertavern.blogspot.com. I have an ongoing chain fiction going on Mondays, and alternating Wednesdays and Fridays will be posts about game design and animated films I've been watching recently, my sort of discussion about them and the like, and maybe occasionally some random posts about stuff that have happened that I can't really put anywhere else. So, I think that will be it for this episode. Ladies, gentlemen, like, share, subscribe, hold your friends down and force them to listen and get feedback. We need it. All of the delicious feedback. Wait,
we
feedback?
Demand it.
We demand your feedback. It's so threatening, even though we're just trying to be constructive. I think, all right. Time for us to say goodbye until next time. Take care.
Take it easy, everybody.